Will you bring up our translator right now? And thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, good morning. Buenos dias. My name is Kate, and I'm part of the Caracol Interpreters Cooperative. And we're a cooperative based in New York that does language justice work, interpretation, and translation in Spanish and English. Buenos dias, yo me llamo Kate, vengo de la cooperativa Caracol. Somos una cooperativa que se enfoca en el trabajo de la justicia lingüística y hacemos interpretación y traducción en inglés y español. So just this morning, we're going to be interpreting simultaneously from English to Spanish. So if you see me walking around and talking, I'm not being rude, I'm interpreting. Entonces hoy en la mañana vamos a estar haciendo interpretación simultánea. Entonces si me ven caminando por el cuarto hablando, no estoy siendo mal educada, nada más estoy haciendo mi trabajo y interpretando. So just for people that will be presenting in the next few days, remember that it's very important to be conscious of your pace when you're speaking. And also for the audience when you're asking questions, everybody needs to have a good pace when you're speaking because we're following everything you're saying. What's the sign we use for some to say slow down? Yes, can everybody do this? Entonces, una de las cosas bastante importantes para la interpretación simultánea, sabemos que es el paso de la cual se les está hablando. Entonces, siempre hay que mantener consciente el paso a la cual está hablando. Y pues siempre hacemos esta seña para indicar que ya se debe hablar un poco más despacio. Si todos podrían, por favor, hacer esta seña. Gracias. Esta es la seña para decir, por favor, hablen un poco más despacio. I think that's it. Thank you so much for having us. Muchísimas gracias por habernos invitado aquí.
Thank you. Gracias. So, good morning. Buenos dias. My name is Jackie Suprenic, and I will be doing the opening remarks, and then I'll be passing on to our opening panel. Welcome, again, to WISDA. This is our 8th conference. How many of you have been to more than one of these? How many have been to all of these? Oh, okay, good. So we have some reference. I'm so happy about this conference. I am just like, woohoo. We started this, as you know, this conference started in 2002 in College Park, Maryland. And it had 96 people at the first conference. So do you want to know how many people have registered and are here for this conference, now the 8th one? We're about at 325. Ooh. And we have about 10 children / youth here. We have a full child care program being offered, which is a wonderful, wonderful thing for me, like a mom who has two kids. And no, I didn't bring them this weekend, but now we are so far ahead of ourselves and we've come a really long way. I'd like to first mention the Eastern Coordinating Council. I actually had to read that because all I know for the last 2 years since Philadelphia is that I'm on the ECC. So I was like, what is this ECC? Eastern Coordinating Council. We have blue tags on, so if anybody's wondering, you know, why they're, just so that you know, if you need something or something is not functioning and we can troubleshoot it, we will do our best. That's what we're all here. So I just wanted to mention that. It is an honor to serve on this council. It's basically one phone call a month, and then it progresses. And it's a great experience. I've never coordinated an event so big, and I am not the coordinator. I am working on a team of people that everyone is working together. It is the best experience ever. If why I'm talking like this is because I am looking for people just like you to come up here and do this. We will be having some wonderful, wonderful opportunities. If you feel that you like to speak or you don't like to speak, it does not matter. There is a place for everyone who wants to participate and do this for our next one that we have in 2017. So if you're interested in that, please please, please look at this ECWD board nomination form. You can self-nominate yourself. You can have someone else nominate you. You can nominate someone else, but please let them know about it so that, you know, they know what's coming. And you can speak to anyone in the blue tags or anyone, the one person that's been here for 8 conferences. She's also, I think, a good person to go to. Can the people on the ECC raise their hand just to make sure how many of us are in the house? Okay. Yes? Okay, so in case you, like I said, look for the blue tags and you can do that. Thank you so much for all of you, and thank you for my team for working and for you guys for making this possible. So getting back to my plug about elections. Elections for nominating will end at 5 p.m. today. So again, this is what it looks like. This will be the sheet. Grab one of these or bring one to someone you know that you'd like to see them. The theme. Can anybody tell me the theme? Does anybody know? Go ahead. Awesome. Thank you. Now the rest of you all know. Okay. Our theme this year reflects the exciting development and growth as we are undergoing as a community. Our theme this year is called Connecting for Impact. And we chose it because we want to celebrate the innovative ways that all kinds of democratic enterprises are scaling up their impact. Whether it's securing city funding for development or converting privately owned businesses to worker co-ops. Does that sound like something we'd like to do?
Yes.
We want to continue, we want to make it better? Yes? Is it lack of coffee or is it me? It's not me, is it? All right. So in our opening plenary, you'll hear inspiring stories from 4 women who have built bridges to connect with workers and funders across all different sectors of society to make incredible impact on the workplace democracy movement, as in their broader communities. And before I hand the mic over to Jessica, I want to take a moment to recognize our sponsors. Like I said, we started out with 96 and we have 325 and 10 youth. And a lot of that would not be possible if it's not for the donations and the sponsorship of individuals, organizations, grassroots fundraising, all of that. It takes a lot to put all of this together, and it's so self-fulfilling and really, but we need that financial support. So I would like to give just quick thank yous to our generous supporters. We were able to raise over $38,000 this year with contributions from individual grassroots donors, sponsors, and groups. And if you're wondering where the money is going, the money goes towards financial aid, interpretation and translation, and childcare costs. We received over 100 applications for financial aid, and we were able to offer some kind of help to everyone that applied. So I think that's it. That's great. But if you feel, and hopefully you will feel, that you want to still support us, we are selling raffles downstairs. And there are a whole bunch of wonderful goodies and things that you might be able to win. So the raffles are $1 per one. You get 6 for 5 and 13 for $10. So I'm hoping that if that's something that tugs at your heart and you can do, please support us so that we can continue this great work. Yes? So here we lie at $6,000, which is Ralph K. Morris Foundation. Can I have a round? CHS Foundation. And over $3,000, the U.S. Federation for Worker Cooperatives, Democracy at Work Institute. Fund for Democratic Communities. $2,000 contribution, equal exchange. I love that. The ICA group. Over $1,000 in support for our wonderful conference. The National Cooperative Business Association. Cooperative Foundation. And of course, all of you who also have contributed. So give yourself a round of applause. Thank you again so much. So I already, and it's been kind of mentioned several times, but again, we have a number of Spanish speakers with us today. And we just want to take a moment to recognize them along our amazing interpretation team that we have here. Let's keep in mind that we speak slowly. If you want to speak to someone who speaks Spanish and want to practice your Spanish perhaps, downstairs at registration there was a little yellow tag. It indicates A, you're bilingual, or you want to practice Spanish. So please, if that's something that interests you or you want to have that in mind, please know that. And I believe, I'm looking at my notes, it's hard, is okay. We are good here. I'm going to give the mic over without any further ado to Jessica! Then we have Jessica Gordon! She's a moderator for our panel. Thank you so much. I will ask to be let back on at the end so that I can do some housekeeping and some final adjustments on your wonderful programs. Okay? Thank you for your time.
Good morning. There actually still seats up in front. I hate when people just all sit in the back and leave the front rows open. So please either move up or encourage people to come in and fill in. Thank you all for being here. Another historic event. Every year, I think every time we have this, we seem to have more and more people attending. So that's really great. And of course, I think this year we were able to offer more scholarships than ever before as well. So. Excited about that. We raised more money than ever, so we're in great shape. What we wanted to do with this opening panel is to really set the stage for talking about connecting for impact by looking even more closely into some of the connections between co-op development, co-ops, and communities. So we have a variety of people up here, but hopefully you also recognize that we have an all women of color panel. Thank you. Talk to us about Quebec and the connection between co-ops and community, but she unfortunately had to drop out at the last minute. But I don't think you'll be sorry for who's left. So, most of you know because you're in the co-op movement and you're co-ops yourselves, but in addition to that democratic participation piece, one of the other really huge important pieces about co-ops is their connection to community. And P6, Principle 6, Concern for Community. We wanted to really highlight those connections, both the ways that co-ops reach out to their communities and do things with and for their communities, and co-ops as a community development strategy, but also we wanted to look at the ways that the rest of the solidarity economy also connects with co-ops. So we've got people here who are going to be able to talk about both directions, right? How solidarity economy institutions and organizations that they're involved in connect with co-ops and support and develop co-ops, and then they'll also be talking about some of the co-ops that they work with and their connections to community and solving community problems. One of the things I talk about in my research is the ways that cooperatives really satisfy community needs and their way for people to come together in a democratic way and satisfy community needs, like credit unions providing affordable financial services, or food co-ops providing affordable, healthy, organic food or vegetarian foods, that kind of thing. Or worker co-ops providing actual decent jobs where people can control their own work rules and actually make a living. And in a worker co-op, you also get that dividend back, so you're also earning assets, developing assets. So we want to look at those kind of things, but we also want to look at how cooperatives can help us solve current issues, like how do immigrant people find jobs or find work or reintegrate better into the society, given the fact that they're often, you know, considered the least among us, kind of thing. Or how people who are in prison or returning citizens, how do co-ops help to solve or address some of the issues they're raising or they're involved in? Looking at low-income people and how we can use co-ops to really provide that control over your economy and dignified work and things like that. So you'll see our panel's going to talk about that. I just wanted to give you a couple more sort of facts about what we're learning about co-ops in our communities, and then I'm going to start with our panel, and I think I will introduce them all at once and then we'll just go seamlessly one to the other. There will be a chance at the end for question and answers, and it looks like I probably will have to give my mic to the audience, so we'll probably have people lined up over here if you want to speak. I also have a few follow-up questions I'll ask the panel after they finish to start us off, and then we'll see if we have too many questions. I might have to figure out another model, but we'll see. If we have a few questions, you can line up here and we'll figure that out. So just quickly, we know that cooperatives address market failure. They provide goods and services, and as we said, quality work where it's not often offered. We also know that cooperatives contribute billions of dollars to their communities, both in wages and products, sometimes in dividends. And we know that cooperatives actually have longer lifespan than regular small businesses. They last longer in the first year, and they last longer in the first 5 years, which is something people don't always recognize. So they actually provide stability in communities, not just community ownership and a way for communities to keep money recirculating, but also actual stability because they are often have much longer longevity. Am I speaking okay? They also, a lot of co-ops also actually give back to the community in donations and volunteer time. Some co-ops use their space, like if they have a building or an office or whatever, they'll loan out their rooms for community meetings and things like that. So there's lots of different ways. I think any of you can think about either your co-op or a co-op that you know about, and think about all the different ways. Co-ops also really help to educate their communities, right? Not only do they educate their own members and their board, but they often provide some kind of public education. If it's a food co-op, they often have a community board where they talk about information or give information about food and things like that. Many of the other co-ops also have different ways that they help us to understand things and also talk about what a co-op is. Equal Exchange, if you look on their wrapping, most of the time something on their wrapping tells you about their farmers or the co-op model or worker ownership, so there's always a teachable moment. And last but not least, we know that worker co-ops have been really paving the way for livable wages and benefited jobs, especially in industries that don't always provide those. So we have some great examples like in healthcare, home healthcare, and other areas where the being in a worker co-op is not only a better experience, but it also allows you to make a real living middle class type of job out of an industry that had always been very low wage and high turnover. So with that, I'm going to introduce our panel. We're going to start with Vanessa Brandsburg from the Center for Family Life. You luckily have the bios in your program, so I'm really not going to waste our time, though I want to honor them by talking about all their accomplishments, but I also want to give them the time to actually talk about their topic. So, Vanessa, everybody's in your program, but Vanessa's at the Center for Family Life, and she started out as a social worker. There's interesting, I actually had a student call me because he's a social worker in California and is actually doing his thesis on social work in co-ops, and he was trying to find information, which is very little. Yeah, I told him to talk to you. So there's a growing movement now of connecting that work, social work and co-op development. And so she'll talk about what she does at the Center for Family Life and what some of the co-ops they've been incubating do. We'll then move on to Lee Marie Nieves from Puerto Rico, who's going to talk about their exciting program of using co-ops in prisons and the co-op education and program she does. And actually, I hope she's going to tell us about how she convinced the corrections department to actually allow these co-ops and to allow her to come in and do the education. And then we'll wrap up with Alandria Williams from Highlander Center, who's going to talk about all the different connections with the solidarity economy, Black Lives Matter, co-op education, governance, co-op development, and youth development. You know, Alandra, she can talk about anything and everything. So that was supposed to be a compliment. So without further ado, we'll start with Vanessa.
Folks, and I think in Central America as well. That's
at that point, we basically approached some of the women that were using the family counseling program in the ESL classes and talked to them about this idea of a worker co-op, and it was very appealing for them, and it actually very much resonated for them. I think mostly because they had been already working doing domestic work, mostly childcare and cleaning, but working isolated, maybe not getting paid at times, maybe in conditions that were poor. And so it was very appealing to be able to rely on other women and their cooperative to look for work that was decent, to be able to learn how to negotiate salaries and contracts. So that's the point that we started. We did it basically in partnership with the women in the neighborhood that were already, which I think actually was a very big strength of building that relationship, because the trust was already there with the organization. They had already known their counselors for a long time and really trusted the process, which was very necessary because it was very new for us too. We were learning with them, we were learning with each other. So since then, since 2006, we've done a lot of other things. At this point, we're working with four older cooperatives, CISA Puede, Beyond Care, Golden Steps, and Trusty Amigos, many of whom are here today. And then four new co-ops, startup co-ops, some of them are here as well, La Mayan, which is also going to be a cleaning cooperative, brand new, Kaluk, which is also here, a handiwork co-op, and then also Sunset Scholars, which is going to provide tutoring. So basically, I'm going to talk a little bit about why it's important, the work that we do being based in a community-based organization. So as I was saying, the women that came out of this initial cleaning cooperative, we're using some of the services, and over the years we found that that's a very typical sort of situation for somebody to be connected, for example, to using after-school programming. That's very useful in terms of childcare, so that the member can actually go out and do their work. And the people in the Center for Family Life, the staff working with them, usually identify some sort of interest or need that person has for work or an entrepreneurship sort of inclination, and then is able to make the referral over to the cooperative development program, where we can meet them and kind of assess which business obviously they would be interested in or have the skills to work in. So this is something that's been very interesting to see. So I have some examples. Some of the members that are in the cooperatives, which is over, I think about, I have to get the exact numbers, but over about 175 members at this point in the co-ops that we're incubating, have been able to take advantage of the free tax filing program that takes place every year. So that's very useful in terms of having a continuum of participating in the business and then being able to kind of be able to get their employer ID number, their ITIN number in order to file taxes, to bring in their family, to get the credits that they're eligible for. And it's a very seamless process. So we're all in the same building. So if, for example, we're talking with a member or we're at a co-op meeting one evening and somebody starts expressing issues that they're having in their home with regards to violence or domestic violence or some sort of trauma that has happened, issue with their children, we're able to either address it there if it's appropriate, or later on with the individual by being able to talk them through it. If, like, I'm a social worker, we have other co-op developers that also happen to be social workers, so there's that ability to kind of be able to do some crisis intervention, and then to be able to connect them to the appropriate programming, most often family counseling, where they're going to be seen not just as an individual, but as a family unit. And so what I've seen over the years, it's more anecdotal, but we are doing some surveys around this, is that when the cooperative members are able to connect to these kinds of services that address issues within their family unit, they're able to be more present in the cooperative business. Because as you can imagine, if you're distraught by something that's happening for yourself or for your family member, it's going to be hard to focus and to give time and create space to be able to go to meetings, to be able to do your work in an effective way, and to communicate your needs to your fellow co-op members. So that's been something that's been very, very your soul.
And I think it's unique about the work that we're doing with former members in the sense of our community. I like to give us another example that I feel very proud about. We sometimes host workshops by UHAB. I can't remember exactly what it stands for, but the Cooperative Housing Organization in New York. And they've come out a few times, and it's actually turned out that a couple of members have been able to purchase their own co-op housing. So I think that's another really amazing thing that has happened, just by being able to kind of present not just information related to their specific co-op and what's going on with that enterprise, and kind of seeing it as an isolated process, to be able to make that connectivity and for them to really have that experience, an experiential thing, you know, not just talking about it, that you are able to kind of, it's an ecosystem that you're within, and you can utilize other resources that we have in New York City that are within the solidarity economy, you know? Another really interesting sort of work that we've been doing is helping the cooperatives organize into an association or a network. So it's very new, it's been around for about 2 years, and it's called Cooperativas Unidas for Sunset Park, or COUSP, Cooperatives United for Sunset Park. And the idea behind that is for them to create, there's a lot of sort of benefits that we're hoping will come out of it, the members do too, a peer learning network, so that they're able to mentor one another, to be able to learn about their challenges and things that they've gone through over the years. So for example, recently, there was a train the trainers on facilitation of meetings. So we did a training for just a few of the key leaders of the cooperatives, and then they went ahead and redid this training for their own co-ops. Also, they've been able to lend money to one another. So Trusty Amigos, the pet sitting co-op, dog walking, has been able to take a small loan from Si Se Puede, one of the older cooperatives. That was very useful, I think, for them to do some marketing. In addition, there's hopes, there's large hopes to be able to eventually create, we're hoping, a group health insurance rate, because that's been one of the most difficult things to kind of figure out with the community members that we're working with. There's a lot of barriers to get health insurance, as many of you know, to be on the exchange. And eventually to be able to do some group purchasing so that group purchasing, for example, to be able to host the web hosting to be based in WUSP so that it becomes more affordable for each of the cooperatives to utilize that service rather than having it be done individually. So there's going to be a lot of trainings, a lot of mentorship, and just simply, I think, being in the same room and learning about kind of things that come up on the day-to-day with management, is extremely insightful for the members. So that's something that we've been supporting them with right now. And they just had a family day in the park because they are constantly expressing the importance first and foremost to get to know each other on a personal level. So they hung out all day last Sunday in the park. And lastly, there's a lot of other ways that we're all connecting, but maybe I'll leave it for the end. I think obviously one of the most important things is the way that the cooperative members that we're working with are connecting to the New York City Coalition, which was mentioned yesterday. And I would identify that as a challenge because the members are very busy. So it's very hard for them to find time to participate in advocacy work. So that's something I think that we're really trying to figure out together as a coalition and talking with members to ask them what would make it easier, because obviously it's very important for them to be involved in that work. And maybe lastly, I wanted to mention an interesting alliance, because I was asked to also mention sort of not just cooperative members involved in locally in the community, but also in other movements aside from co-op work. And that's with the Caring Across Generations campaign. The Golden Steps Elder Care Cooperative has been involved for the last couple of years in this campaign that focuses on fascinating, advocating for the improvement of the caring field. So not only for the workers, but also for the clients, the older people, and then their families. So that it's a triangular and beneficial approach. And they have been involved by utilizing the trainings that are coming out of that, which is specifically a nanny training that comes out of that campaign. That's very good, and it's done within the Cornell University program there, the Labor Institute there. And then also there's been opportunities to receive referrals from different aging communities around New York City. So that's obviously a very excellent tangible benefit that the cooperative is able to get, to be able to connect with potential clients that are needing companionship, non-medical companionship care, and wanting to do the right thing by hiring people that are working in a democratic workplace. So maybe I'll stop there.
Because they are
the neighbors. Esta cooperativa es como cualquier otra. en una junta directiva se reúne anualmente con sus socios para informar las ganancias y los materiales que tienen que comprar se llevan a consenso.
So this is like any other co-op. They have a board of directors, they have a yearly meeting with the members, and they are transparent with all decisions and purchases and
mi trabajo es en el enlace con el sistema correccional y aclaro mi trabajo voluntario no comprometido.
And my work is to work directly to the prison system. I do this work voluntarily in my own opinion.
Y mi trabajo es hacer entender el sistema que a mayor proveer de educación y herramientas de autogestión, menor va a ser la incidencia.
And my job is to prove the system that more education and tools you give to them, more autosufficient are them.
Así que el sistema gasta por el primer año de un confinado $43,000.
So the system spends $43,000 a year for them to be in prison.
Y después todos los años que siguen son 28,000 cada año.
And after, every year after, it's $28,000 each year.
En mi país invierte $5,000 por cada estudiante.
Okay.
In my country, it has $5,000 for each student.
Así que tenemos una desigualdad terrible, menos educación y mucho ingreso a la cárcel.
So our country makes this very unequal investment, $5,000 any youth in education, $28,000 in their jail.
Así que probamos con números y estadísticas que si adoptan.
Statistics that if they take on my model, they will have more success in our country.
Tenemos la primera cooperativa de mujeres que se fundó hace solo 2 años.
We have the first co-op of women in the last 2 years.
El sistema discrimina contra mujeres.
The system is discriminatory against women.
Es muy difícil entrar en una prisión en Puerto Rico.
It's very hard to be in a prison. It's very hard even to keep them alive.
Así que es una población mucho más complicada.
It's a much more complicated population.
Pero ganamos una batalla y es la presidencia que es la máxima seguridad que supone que se ha llevado a cabo.
And won even a bigger battle because the president of the board, she is in a maximum security position. She had never had to be.
Así que poco a poco construimos.
So, little by little, we've been building.
Trabajamos una tercera cooperativa y vayamos a nuestro pueblo.
We're working in a third co-op in Bayamón.
Bayamón.
This is another little town.
Estos jóvenes están en un proyecto piloto donde están obtienen un grado universitario.
These youth are in a pilot project where they obtain a university degree.
Yo entiendo que el tema es apropiado porque desde mi país y con jóvenes como Roberto que lo van a ver en la tarde, estamos construyendo un puente inmenso.
I understand that it's a challenge, but in my country we see this, as you can see this afternoon with
Roberto.
We're building a bridge.
Así que cuando conozcan a Roberto entenderán que más allá de mis palabras, el cooperativismo reeduca y es posible transformar ese mundo.
So when you meet me, Roberto, this afternoon, you will understand that co-ops re-educate people and they can transform people.
Así que algún otro detalle. Mi país tiene actualmente 12,400 refugiados.
My country has 12,400 people in prison.
Y se proyecta para que para el próximo año sean 16,000.
And it's projections for next year to be 16,000.
I don't know.
Something is really wrong.
Entiendo que el cooperativismo es la solución para nosotros.
And I understand that the co-op movement is the solution for our problem.
Nuestros jóvenes están lanzando. trabajando proyectos con grupos finados al gobierno para ahorrar dinero y ser ellos los que limpien afuera, devuelven el patio común a la mano de ellos.
So they have posted the government that to give them jobs, meaning schools or doing gardening work and save money for the government. It's enhanced the government.
Adiós en la puerta y le lanzo el reto a Estados Unidos para que comience a ser cooperativa de aquí a la inversión. Se puede.
So, Arias, is the door that we have been open to the government for them to change.
Cuando quieran alguna información sobre el reglamento, cómo se logró, estamos a sus órdenes aquí para ayudarles porque entendemos que Estados Unidos debe implementar.
So if somebody has questions of how we work this with the law and how to implement something like this, contact me and I will give you all the information.
Yes,
thank you.
The workshop is tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. They're really making us get up early. It's the one called Cooperative Ownership in the Prison Industrial Complex, a case study for Puerto Rico, in room Jonas Clark 102 at 9 a.m. And can we have Roberto, I guess, stand up? He's one of the founders of Cooperativa Argos and is out. And they'll tell you more about it tomorrow morning for those of you who can make that session. Thank you. And now I'll enter.
Hello, everybody. All right. So, Kim, if you can stand if you're really big, please. Stand on up. So, I come from Youth Organizing the World. And me and panels have our complicated. So, just put everything down. Unless you ever throw it. Stomp out injustice. And blow in the winds of change. Blow in the winds of change. Reach down the grassroots. Reach up to the sky, pray for it. Stomp out injustice. And blow in the winds of change. Reach down the grassroots. Reach up to the sky, pray for it. Stomp out injustice. Blow in the winds of change. All right, good job. All right, sit down. And so we're running on time, so I'm gonna make mine shorter, but hit it a little harder, because we only have so much room. And so not saying anything that you just did. So I work at the Pioneer Center. We're in East Tennessee. We work in the Southern United States, gay and south. And so we support grassroots community leaders and people that are trying to make change in their communities. And that can be around economics. It can be around racial justice. We're not an act. We're not a single issue organization. We're a liberation organization. Right. So I'll do the metronome because I have to slow down. But I also can only go so slow. Otherwise, we'll be here way too long. But I will do my best. I'm a very fast talker. but we're a liberation organization. And so that's kind of our framework and group. And so we were started in the middle of the Great Depression in 1932 by five radical Christian socialists. And we are basically a socialist organization today, although we don't always use those words. But I'm saying that so you'll have an idea of where I'm coming from. And they were pretty radical about it, and we don't hold punches. And so Highlander, beautifully got to be a part of the Solidarity County Network. When it started up in Atlanta, Georgia. And so I was on the board with Emily Kawano and other people. And so out of that, I became involved in the Solidarity Economy Movement. that in that kind of a network way, even though we have been doing the work for a really long time. So we're 84 years old, and in the 84 years helped start co-ops, stopped doing co-op development, and are now back in doing work with co-ops, but all due to trying to work around economics and racial justice. And the reason why we ended up doing work around racial justice as them, because they were at that point a white institution, was you can't actually change the economic system in the country without dealing with race. And that you had to actually, every time. Because that was the linchpin. And so my organization, most people know it as a place that Rosa Parks came through, Martin Luther King came through, everyone that's done a lot of work around justice work, especially in the U.S. South, but also globally, has come through for training and education and network building and how we can grow stronger. So the things that I want to talk about are the Southern Grassroots Congress Project, in which there are people that are members here. So Cooperation Texas back there, Woo, the Fund for Democratic Communities, GEO, the Working Girls, Dolly, and the various work co-ops, who else am I missing? Of the Federation of Semi-Cooperatives, Florida Farmers Association, and Cooperation Texas. No, I said Cooperation Jackson. I'm sorry, y'all, I'm sorry. And so SGP got started, and we do three basic things, right? We're trying to help start a fund, the Center for Reparations Loan Fund, beautiful name, right? To do some policy work, because if people don't know, there's no southern state that has co-op enabling legislation. And we want to be like our amazing folk in Puerto Rico, because prisons are a major issue where we live. That is the highest part is the prison state. And we also are doing education work. Because if you don't know what co-ops are, you don't actually know how to live into their principles, then it doesn't matter, right? And people need jobs in a whole different way. And need to figure out how they actually love themselves and have different ways of doing other things. So I'm going to put all this down and ask you to explain it. And not look at it anymore, because then I'm not going to do it anymore. So I just came back from Italy. So I was in Italy for 2 weeks, in a million reminder. And the thing that struck me there, that strikes me in how we do our work with SGP, is that the reason why co-ops for them are strong is about because they want a radical poverty. They want radical liberation, and they're doing it for humanity, right? It's not the cute thing that you do on the side because you want to be a fringe, marginal group that can just hang out with your little people. It's done because people's very essence needs it, right? And so that's why some of the co-ops that are in this world exist, is because at their very essence, that is like a life-giving force for us to do radical transformation of our communities and of our world. And that's why we exist. So our task is how do we help do that, right? In a Black Lives Matter moment, which should be always, right? So I got started around this work, yes, out of economics, but also getting sexist, what about the police, right? So how do we hold that we are multiple things at once and that we need all those things to exist, right? So how does a co-op world in this time come to terms with what do we do around Black Lives Matter, right? Not just go to the rally and the protest, because that's cute, but in the end, that's not enough. And I love the turnip. The turnip is great, and so hopefully y'all will turn up sometimes, right? And I hope you don't know what the turnip means. We can talk about it later. Go slower than that. I need to go back home. So, and I talk faster right now. But we also need to figure out how we help build infrastructure in a different way. And that's what SGP is about. Because at one point there were Black businesses that were cooperatives. At one point there were Black banks that were more like cooperative banks. When the Federation of Southern Cooperatives started, they were building things. And now they are barely able to do what they have to do because people are actively trying to tear them down. And so the question of the day is, how do we not just say I support Black Lives Matter in an esoteric, theoretical way, but actually put our money where our mouth is, and put our bodies where our mouth is, and put our feet where our mouth is. So I do a lot of work around migration, right? Because I don't call it immigration, I call it migration. Because people migrate, they don't immigrate, just don't. Right? So, and I live in the U.S. South, right? So in Alabama, Tennessee, all of our southern states, it's been a battle. Like it's been a battle other places. But where we are, it's been pretty, it's been a whole nother level. And so a lot of the co-ops that got started because people couldn't work. And we were like, how do we hold deportations that are happening at the very moment that these are the cooperative members who are about to get deported? How do we really work with that? How do we fight on that? And so we did this thing called Phrase, because I'm going to provide two examples and then leave. So Threads, we brought together people across the region to say, how do we hold both economic justice organizations, people who are trying to do alternative democratic work around economics, and people who are doing justice work, right? All those three levels, and bring them together coming from the same place so that people could actually learn how to work with each other long haul. So this thing lasted for a year and a half because people needed to build deep relationships. People wouldn't even get in the car together. The black people wouldn't get in the car with the Latino folk. People who were doing this work wouldn't get in the car with the other people. And we were like, if you can't even get in the car together, how are we gonna have different communities together, right? So if we are in our own little universes, so I do economic development work over here, I do co-ops over here, but I'm a worker co-op and can't talk to another co-op, how can you talk to people that are doing radical justice work on the ground? And that was me. And so what ended up happening is we stopped 27 Gs all over the South. And if people don't know what 27 Gs are, we can talk about it later. But let's people not be high sentence. And so what ended up happening is there's in New Orleans a new co-op called Veggie Farms. And Veggie Farms is mostly Vietnamese, and they do soy and tofu and all kinds of stuff, right? So Veggie Farms is hooked up with Kids Rethink New Orleans. Kids Rethink New Orleans got started after Hurricane Katrina. And they do a lot, and they got started a little before then, and have done work since then, around really trying to shift the way that food is done in schools. And because if people don't know about right after Katrina, they ended up breaking the school districts off into their own little consolidated districts. And so they've been organizing as 12-year-olds and 11-year-olds and 14-year-olds and 15-year-olds and 17-year-olds doing more radical work than half the adults could ever think about doing. And they have really, and so they've come together, and they came together first at some of these things, and are like, how do we do this work? How do we shift the food systems? How do we shift the schools? And then how do we create our own stuff? And so it's all encompassing. And so that to me is what hope looks like. So when we talk about impact, we talk about impact in terms of scale a lot of times, right? Let's figure out how we can work with this in the city government. But we don't go, what's the other impact we need to have on people's basic everyday lives so people can survive? And whose impact are we talking about? So the last thing I think I want to say, because it came up a lot the other day, yesterday, is around governance and who's in control and who's not. And the thing that I think I find most beautiful about the Southern Grassroots Economics Project, and we did a thing also called the Appalachian Transitions Fellowship Program, which Dan Taylor is somewhere, I think, in this room, who I met in West Virginia, is our whole thing was how do we put people most directly impacted at the center of the work, period. Everybody else can be involved and engaged, but at the core is people who are from that place, rooted in that place, and from does not mean I was born and raised. From means I live here, and I'm here for now, right? But directly impacted in terms of the issue going on. And in the fellowship program, we were like, how do we also like push every boundary? Like, how do we get trans people, undocumented people, like young black people who had money, people who came from someone who was the mayor, all in the same spot to shift a region, right? So yesterday, like this crazy announcement came through, and this all this stuff is happening around some of the work that people have done. And to sit there and watch two young people, 22 and 23, move over half, what did they move, like $450 million? They helped increase that movement of money. That's a lot of money, y'all. They like did something that nobody else could do with the Bain Environment Fund. And then the money keeps coming. Like, right? And so organizations that are co-ops are getting the resources. And it's a beautiful thing because a lot of the co-ops don't even know where it comes from. And then they will never know the work that these young people put in. And that's all right. But it's like how we can see it replicated. And so I just want to leave with saying to please get involved in the justice making organizations in your hometown. Because people need radical transformation and people need to figure out how they have a different economy now. and what our economy is going to look like in the future. We cannot leave folk out of the conversation. Worker co-ops cannot be the movement it was 20 years ago, amen. It can't be the movement it is now, amen. It's got to be something different. It could be radically different. We can't say we just want to like be a little merger. We want to take over. The lesson I learned in Italy is take over the whole thing. Like, we don't want to take this one. We have a whole thing. And if we have to do it, we need to take that whole thing. That includes changing ourselves internally, changing how we work with each other, and going, let me not just go out into the community and assume people don't know what cooperation is, but say, maybe you actually do know what it is, because you had to do it forever, because you had nothing to live on. We just need to figure out how to help provide you the stuff you need to make it happen. That's what our job is. I have thousands of examples of things that we can do, but we don't have time for that. But this is what I do need people to do. So, Kiki, I have Asana Shakur on my body. Because... So, I'm living here to go to Roots and Remedies in North Carolina, which is some stuff I do with people groups, organizing groups, and economic development groups that people led by people of color organizers. And then helping do stuff at the Black Lives Matter Conference, Move for Black Lives. So if you're black and you want to go to Move for Black Lives Matter Conference, you need money to get there, let me know. That's what I do right now, is raise money to get people places. But can we please do an aside quote? And so so we're going to start soft, then go louder, and then you want to shake the roots off. And so please repeat after me. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love and support each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. And if you were here yesterday and you saw the video when Ricky talked about how the chains went from the ankles to the mind, if those were the only chains you could imagine your ego having, think about those chains, right? Because we all got chains in our minds. So I needed people to like feel the quote. And feel your, we got it. Okay, ready? We're going next thing. It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
We must love and support each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. Okay, stand up. Because you gotta like take it from the plate down. All right.
Thank you.
And it's from your foot. And if I'm laughing you, it's really bad. Because you've got to make the whole campus hear this.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
It is our duty to win.
We must love and support each other.
We must love and support each other.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
That's it.
We only had an hour and a half, then we started 15 minutes late, and now it's almost time to end. So I need to do two quick things. I wanted to summarize a little bit of what you heard. I wanted to tell you about a couple of workshops that follow up on this topic, and then I need to hand it back over to Jack.
Yes.
So I'll cut back what I was going to summarize, but you basically heard about people and community building, right? That's really what the whole thing was about. We don't really want to use the term empowering people because people already have power, right? We're talking about people who have assets and deploying those assets, helping people to deploy them, to use them collectively so they have more power. And you see in all these examples, a variety of ways that people were able to do that through co-ops, the co-op movement, through other groups that tapped into the co-op movement, that kind of thing. The threads notion, right? You heard it from when Vanessa talked about the co-ops actually connecting with each other and moving from a worker co-op to also having ownership in a housing co-op to connection between worker co-ops. You saw the connections between the co-op community in Puerto Rico and the prison system, and then the development actually from the prisoners themselves. They demanded the co-op education to start with, right? But then they got support from the co-op community to keep doing what they were doing. And you see from Alandria all those different threads connecting all the social racial justice movements to to unleashing the power of people through co-op ownership as well as other kinds of social movements. So hopefully we got you energized for the rest of this conference. We've given you themes and ideas and things to follow. We also practiced language justice, which I hope you recognized. And so there are several workshops that, you know, follow up on some of these themes. Today there's the six principle workshop. There's the labor workshops. The first one is organized labor unions and co-ops. There's, I think, two or three caucuses and youth workshops. And then on Sunday, as we said, there's the one for the Puerto Rican co-ops. Unfortunately, it's also at the same time as the advancing cooperative economies in the South, from slavery to genocide. So if you're traveling with a group, half of you go to one of those, and the other half go to the other and share back what you've learned. And there's also, I can't read my own handwriting, a couple other workshops that you should be really interested in. Thank you so much for coming. Give it back to Jackie. Enjoy the day, and remember what you heard here.
Thank you, all of our panelists and participants, for moderating. Thank you once again for your time and your service to give back and to for all of us to open up our minds. Okay, quickly, because I do want to get you to the places you need to be. Things that are important for you to know. There are two sessions. Make sure that you know that the Grace and Laurie are here behind registration. So if you're going to a session that are in those, that's where they are located. Does everyone know where Jonas Clark Building is? No, okay. If you open up your program, there is a map on page 2, I believe. Page 5, I now am corrected, that has exactly where you have to go. This program has everything that you need. Take time to read it. It has endless amount of information. But just to let you know, one of our sessions was canceled, and it's on page 12. It's Scaling Values, a panel discussion on growing the cooperative economy. It's location Jonas Clark 215. If you have that noted as your session that you wanted to attend, you will not be able to attend that. I don't have a substitution for it, and there will be nothing in that space. So please make that. But there is a workshop addition that is not in your program, and it's Sunday on Block 4 at Jonas Clark Room 104. It's called Organizing Around Worker Cooperatives, Food Systems in Rural Areas. It has Joe Marafino on it, it has Jonah Bird and Nikki, and I didn't finish writing the names. So anyway, but that's on Sunday. If you need that information, just please see any of us in the blue tags. Everybody knows about meals. Our event is that we will be having the ending, you know, the part where we want to eat and have an event there. It's going to be at the Woo. And that information is on the bottom of page 5 underneath. It tells you. It's $8.75. You can walk there, so you don't need to worry about that. It's four blocks from here. Just have that in mind. And if there's any other major questions, just see one of us. We'll try to help you out as quickly as we can. There will be breaks, snacks at 3 o'clock. About the Woo. Yes, hold on 1 second.
I just want to let people know the Woo Church is 4 blocks away on the map. Program is pointing the wrong direction,
so go
4 blocks
the other
direction, which will be towards downtown.
All right,
then.
Thank you. Party was going to be somewhere else, but you thought it was at the room. Okay, that is it for me. I told you about that. Oh, yes, yellow paper slips is your workshop evaluation. Please, this is how we make it better. You know, we hear back what it is that you need, what you want. So please, at the end of whatever session you're at, fill it out. It takes 30 seconds. there is space to write on the back. Any questions? No? Okay. Have fun. Enjoy.